these pessimistic predictions, India has overcome enormous socio-economic challenges to emerge as the world's largest functioning democracy with a stable polity and vibrant economy. The recently held general elections in India in April to May 2009 was the largest democratic exercise the world has ever seen, with over 600 million voters casting their vote in a free and fair manner. More people in India exercise their franchise than the entire population of Europe. In recent years, India's GDP growth rate has been among the highest in the world. Our GDP is expected to grow at about 7% for the next few years. In fact, India's extraordinary economic growth over the last few decades has made it the sixth largest economy in the world, with a GDP of $2.7 trillion last year. Let me put this in perspective. It took us almost 43 years after independence to grow from about $30 billion to $300 billion by 1990. But we are adding the equivalent of $300 billion in GDP every year now. Our Prime Minister has set a target of expanding our GDP to cross $5 trillion by 2024. But with a lot of emphasis on sustainable development. India has also emerged as one of the most attractive investment destinations for FDI. And last year, we attracted $64 billion. In fact, in the last 5 years, we received FDI of about $286 billion, which is almost 50% of the FDI that we had received in all the years before that. We sometimes tend to get surprised by statistics about India, I must admit. But India is the largest producer of milk in the world. We are also the second largest producer of rice and wheat, as well as fruits and vegetables. We are the second largest producer of steel, higher than the US. I was a little surprised myself. And also the second largest producer of cement. We are the largest manufacturer of two-wheelers, three-wheelers and tractors. And we've also emerged as the fourth largest automobile market last year. We're doing rather well in renewable energy, where we have the fourth largest capacity in wind and the fifth largest capacity in solar power in the world. As of June 2019, we had installed 80 gigawatts of renewable energy. And an additional 45 gigawatts of hydropower. We have ambitious targets. So we've set a target of reaching 225 gigawatts of renewable energy by 2022 and a massive 500 gigawatts by 2030. This is an area where we can have excellent cooperation with Denmark. Relations between India and Denmark go back to over 400 years. And in fact, this year we are celebrating the 400th anniversary of the establishment of the Danish enclave in Trankebar on the east coast of India. Denmark has also had smaller enclaves such as Serampore in West Bengal, where they've built a tavern. They've renovated an old building to make it a tavern, and also Nicobar Islands. The Danish colonies were handed over or sold to the British. This year we are also celebrating the 70th anniversary of establishment of diplomatic relations, so do watch out for a plethora of cultural programs. The foundation for a robust relationship between India and Denmark was established in 1957 when then Prime Minister Jawaharlal Nehru visited Denmark. Since then, bilateral ties have grown from strength to strength. Although there was a brief hiatus between 2011 to 2016, I'm happy to report that there have been intensified high-level exchanges in the last 2.5 years. There have been 8 ministerial visits from Denmark to India in this period, and 3 from India to Denmark. The last year has seen a remarkable deepening and broadening of bilateral cooperation. After a considerable gap of 9 years, the two prime ministers met in Stockholm for the first ever Nordic summit in April 2018. In January 2019, former Danish Prime Minister Lars Løkke Rasmussen led a large business delegation to India, where he again met our Prime Minister. Our Prime Minister has coined a phrase which I find has a lot of resonance here. He said that Denmark has the skills while India has the scale. I look forward to working with various Danish organizations and companies in making this a reality and combining Danish technology with Indian expertise. In the last year and a half, I think we have set some records in diplomacy, and perhaps if there was a Guinness book of world records for diplomacy, we could try and have an entry there. But we were able to organize 10 joint working group meetings between different ministries of India and Denmark in sectors of relevance such as renewable energy, agriculture, food processing, science and technology, shipping, environment and urban development. What is interesting is that none of these groups had met before. We've also signed 11 important MOUs and agreements in the last 1.5 years. Our bilateral trade continues to expand. There are about 130 Danish companies in India, but I do hope more of them will enter. And there are about 25 Indian companies here, mainly in the IT, renewable energy and engineering sectors. As I mentioned, we've tried to strengthen cultural cooperation. We see increasing popularity for the International Day of Yoga. We organized a few film festivals last year, and we've screened some Bollywood films. I'm hoping more Danes will get hooked on to Bollywood. We also organize Indian traditional dance and music programs as well as painting exhibitions. The Danish Cultural Institute, which is only the second in Asia, was inaugurated in January this year by the former Danish PM. And we hope this will provide a platform and forum for accelerated cultural exchanges. We've also started direct flights between Copenhagen and Delhi. In fact, I was lucky enough to inaugurate them shortly after arrival. The flights are doing quite well and they've expanded to 4 flights a week. And it's a very convenient timing to get to India. In fact, Scandinavia is becoming an increasingly popular destination. And a visit to Denmark combined with a ferry trip from Copenhagen to Oslo and travel in Scandinavia is increasingly on the agenda of many Indians. There are many links between India and Denmark. Some are well known, but some are not so well known. And I wanted to mention some of these. Our most famous badminton player, Prakash Padukone, had trained in Denmark. He has won the All England Open and also the Danish Open. His daughter, Deepika Padukone, was born here and she is today one of the leading actresses of Bollywood. Last year, I was fortunate enough to see another Indian win the men's Danish Open, K. Srikanth. Most Indians have fond childhood memories of a blue tin with a very cute house on top. And this is none other than the Danish butter cookies. I am told that the Danish butter cookies are still a very popular present during Diwali, which is the most important Indian festival. But the Danish butter cookies are not made in India, they're imported. So I think it shows that there is potential for deepening economic cooperation. As a child, I myself had pleasant memories of having tulip ham and sausages, or playing with Lego toys and reading the fairy tales of Hans Christian Andersen. I'd never imagined that I would one day be ambassador to this beautiful country. Today, people across India still have very warm memories of Denmark's contribution in the dairy sector, which helped increase India's milk production many times. Not many Indians are still aware of where some of the popular Danish products come from. For instance, Carlsberg beer is the second most popular beer in India, but I believe it is a bit of a secret where it originates from. Although the weather is wet today, let me assure you that the future of India-Denmark relations is bright. I am confident that my fellow citizens who consider Denmark their second home will continue to work sincerely and with diligence. We will now be presenting a brief cultural program. I see the rain is also beginning to subside. But let me conclude by thanking all of you for turning out in such large numbers despite the very adverse weather conditions, and that shows your deep commitment to India-Denmark friendship. Thank you.
Nandini.
वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ा पराई जाने रे वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ा पराई जाने रे पर दुखे उपकार करे तो ए मन अभिमान नाने रे वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ा पराई जाने रे सकल लोग मा सोनी बंदे निंदा ना करे केने रे वाच काच मन नीस चले राके धन धन जननी तेनी रे वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे समदृष्टि ने तृष्णा सत्य न बोले पर धन न जाले हाथ रे वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे मोह वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे वण लोभी ने कपट रहित छे काम क्रोध निवारिया रे वण नरसे वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे पर दुखे उपकार करे मन अभिमान नाने रे वैष्णव जन तो तीने कहिए जे पीड़ पराई जाने रे
चन्ना बे तेरी चंद निक तू चन बदला दा
ವಚನ ಬದಲಾವಾರಿ ಹಾಯ್ ಇಕ್ಕ ಬಾರಿ ಮೇಲಕ್ಕೆ ರಾಧೆ ಬಿಚಡೆ ಸಚಡಾದ ಬಿಚಡೆ ಸಚಡಾದ ಚನಾದ ಮೇರಿ ಚಂದನಿಗೆ ತು ವಚನ ಬದಲಾವ ಚನಾದ ಮೇರಿ ಚಂದನಿಗೆ ತು ವಚನ ಬದಲಾವ ಇಕ್ಕ ಬಾರಿ ಹಾಯ್ ಇಕ್ಕ ಬಾರಿ ಮೇಲಕ್ಕೆ ರಾಧೆ
sung by Anita Redfe has attracted the attention of the top in India. And actually the Prime Minister launched the medley when the UN Secretary General Antonio Guterres was visiting Delhi. And last year in December when we had the second joint commission meeting, Danish Foreign Minister Anders Samuelsen was in India. After our Minister for External Affairs had hosted a banquet for him,
at the end of that, she asked for the television to be brought and she played this medley. So there is a combined medley version which is actually, it went around on WhatsApp, so I don't think it would be an exaggeration to say that probably several hundred million Indians have. But thank you. Thank you. Made Denmark better known and more popular.